in Germany. So I'm going to start for a few minutes to talk and motivate this work by sort of looking at some bad things that happen in privacy in the world, and sort of use that as a lens to motivate what we're trying to do, which is the sensitivity sampler. So the goal of that is to automate somehow to remove some of the burden of using differential privacy, not with the goal of replacing anything else, but just maybe another way to do things sometimes. Depending on how slow I go, I'll talk more or less about the Bernstein mechanism, which is another piece of work together that complements the sensitivity sampler. And so it's a function release mechanism. And then hopefully I'll give a plug for a package that implements these ideas. So for those who don't know, Sisyphus is a king in Greek mythology. For crimes he did during life, he was committed to pushing a boulder up a hill forever. So to motivate sampling sensitivity and automating privacy to some extent, I thought it would be interesting to look at the test tube of privacy in Australia, and to look at bad things that have been done in Australia, kind of like this combination of cream cheese and yeast extract. Okay, so I'll talk about two anecdotes of things that have happened in the last few years. The first one is probably the most relevant to differential privacy. So this is in 2016, the Federal Department of Health. Healthcare in Australia is essentially universal. Everyone uses the public health system. The department, under pressure to share data, decided to release 30 years worth of unit record level data of medical billing and pharmaceutical prescriptions for 10% of the population, so a bit over 2 million people. So this is extremely sensitive. It covers what procedures you have, what kind of appointments you have with doctors, also how doctors treat their patients, because you can kind of track a doctor through this data set, and what kind of prescriptions you have for some people their entire lifetime. They had tried to anonymize the data, so they had perturbed dates of billing records. They had not exactly put doctors' IDs in the data set. They had passed them through one-way uninvertible hash functions. And the data set was just put online as a file. You didn't need to register to get it. So with Melbourne colleagues, Vanessa Teague and Chris Colnane, we re-identified doctors in the data set. So we reversed these one-way hash functions, which clearly weren't used properly. Then we re-identified patients in the data set. So you can do things like, you know, nothing groundbreaking for an audience here, looking at the dates that a mother has had children. If the mother has had several children, the dates are quite unique, and you can link them to other information online. And so this is a case of something where maybe they could have used differential privacy. Yeah.
Just linkage attack, not subsets.
Just linkage attack, yeah. It was a different kind of attack to recover the doctor IDs. But for patients, it was linkage. Yeah. So this is something, you know, sharing data, maybe you could do better. You know, we heard yesterday about the US Census Bureau trying to share data with differential privacy. So when we told them about this, they took the data set down, and then they introduced... they tabled legislation to criminalise re-identification. In the same day they announced, like the news came out. It didn't pass, but it hasn't gone away, so it's kind of an ongoing thing. Another example from Australia about privacy isn't differential privacy, but it's the same kind of thing, right? The government, like many governments, worry that cryptography can be used by bad people for bad things. And so they thought about, could we compel companies like Google and Apple that do business in Australia that aren't even headquartered there, could we compel them to, I don't know, let people have access to secret data that's encrypted? And despite lots of people pointing out that this doesn't work because of maths, I mean, cryptography, that's called a backdoor. This was the quote by the then Prime Minister: "The laws of mathematics are very commendable, but the only law that applies in Australia is the law of Australia." So if we legislate that this is not a backdoor, that somehow we're not breaking maths, that it's just a sort of, we're only going to give access to private data for some people, but not everyone, then that's true. Of course it's not. Unfortunately, that actually did pass, even though the legislation wasn't really worked out very much. There was very little polishing of it. You might think that Australia is 14 hours away, but if you're in the US, Canada, UK or New Zealand, it might affect you too. Did you have a question?
I think, who was the Prime Minister?
Malcolm Turnbull. Yeah, so we go through Prime Ministers very quickly. So the previous one, yeah. So we're here talking about lots of privacy protecting technologies and the theory of these things, and largely differential privacy. And differential privacy has had lots of successes, right? And I think that there are key ingredients for these successes, and you know, I don't need to read them out. They're not surprising to many of you, this view. But still, you know, we keep seeing these kinds of things, and this is just one example. There are so many of them, but you would think they would kind of diminish in time because you have these great tools. Not only do they not diminish, but we get respectable organizations like the UK Office for National Statistics, the equivalent of the US Census Bureau, or the Australian Bureau of Statistics, solving privacy with things like this. The order 5 safes. I mean, because there have been extensions with 6 safes and 7 safes, and I can talk more about that later, but I won't now. You can ask me about it in the break. Sorry?
5 anonymity, basically?
No, it's not. It's not 5 anonymity. That might be better than this. Yeah. I said it. Okay. So, when are we sort of there? I mean, clearly, I think we're there already. Differential privacy already works. We've heard talks this week about serious attempts to use differential privacy at scale. maybe we'll be there, you know. But as a sort of tongue-in-cheek, maybe we'll be there when Australia passes a law forbidding differential privacy. We'll know where, as you know, we've made it. And the question about who would the Prime Minister? Yeah, Malcolm Turnbull. Less tongue-in-cheek, maybe, you know, it would be nice to aspire for data scientists and developers to be able to use differential privacy in a very broad sense. So there are lots of great systems that enable differential privacy in sort of restricted analyses. John Ducci yesterday in the panel talked about someone in R just doing their analysis and it being differentially private. So sort of think that. I think that's a nice thing to aspire to as well as lots of great directions that people are taking now. So in this work, we were sort of thinking, what's a pain point that's sometimes a barrier? And one that we sort of identified is sensitivity, bounding sensitivity. And so one of the great things about all of these wonderful building blocks, these sort of the periodic table of elements of differential privacy, is we have these generic mechanisms like Laplace, Gaussian, exponential, etc., and they're really fantastic. You know, we've analyzed them already. People can just use them, and you just need to bound sensitivity in order to invoke them. And I think pretty much every talk this week mentioned global sensitivity or sensitivity at some point. I was trying to keep track. So what does that look like? I mean, many of you know, I'm just using my own work because I don't want to pick on anyone else. This is we were bounding sensitivity of an SVM. This is not the state of the art way of doing privacy preserving SVMs, but it's in a sense for some people in the audience this would be easy. At the time, as a grad student, I'm sure I wouldn't have been able to do it with my fantastic advisor. We leveraged other things. But, you know, I think that it's safe to say a lot of people who might use differential privacy to do something slightly new might find this kind of thing hard. So this work is trying to follow the Prime Minister's example and not use maths. So we don't want to say to people you need to bound sensitivity. And there's lots of related work in this area, and I won't enumerate it, but I'll just sort of mention that some ways that people tackle these kinds of problems is they say we'll have a very general class, but not sort of super general of analyses where we can kind of keep track of sensitivity for you, and there are lots of systems like that that are great. What we wanted to do was to sort of think about, well, any function that you could privatize with one of these generic mechanisms that you need to bound sensitivity for, we'd like to let people use those mechanisms without bounding sensitivity. So we want, that's the class. The classes are the things that can be, you know, you can use generic mechanisms for. So what do we get? What do we get for this work? Well, why should you listen to the rest of the talk? We can privatize, in some sense privatize, and I'm going to talk about that, black box functions. So that they could be something that you've written down on paper. They could be something that you don't have source code for and an executable that you can just run. So we only require Oracle access, so just evaluating functions. We don't require, of course, sensitivity, that's the point. You don't require gradients or anything like that. So one use case is you want to be like Malcolm Turnbull and you don't want to do maths. Another use case could be that you have a mechanism that's well studied. Someone has done an excellent tight global sensitivity bound already, but you don't know that the software you're using necessarily matches what has been analyzed. So in the case of the SVM, if I pull up a standard library for SVMs, is the global sensitivity that we bounded, is it the same? Does it apply to the software? I don't really know. It might be implemented a little bit differently. So that's another use case for this. Now there's a big caveat. So we're going to pay for this. We're going to pay in privacy. So we're going to get something, but it's not what we would typically like. Okay. So and I'll get to that. So like many people, I didn't want to go through the definitions, but I, as a parent of young children, I don't like getting presents without batteries in them. So for those at home, they can look at the slide more slowly. I've highlighted the things I just want to mention, that often when you're doing differential privacy and you're using generic mechanisms, you've got some function that doesn't preserve privacy. It might be the analysis you want to run. It might be something related to the analysis you want to run. It's taking a database and it's returning things in some normed space. Okay, we've heard about sensitivity a lot. This is global sensitivity. It's relative to the norm, and it's also relative to whatever your relation is on databases. And so for things like pufferfish that we heard about earlier today and blowfish, you could have different relations, or it could be the usual one. And then, like I've said, there are lots of wonderful, really useful building blocks in differential privacy, these like generic mechanisms that need to have this sensitivity measured in order to guarantee privacy. Okay, so that's the batteries. So there are kind of, I don't know how to count them, there are kind of two ideas, and they're really simple, I think. So basically I'm going to derive the sensitivity sampler and prove it as I go, and then I'll say what the result is. So the first idea starts with a definition, and it looks a lot like the definition of pure differential privacy, but I'm not quantifying for all databases, okay? So I'm just saying for any sensitivity level and for any pair of databases, they might be neighboring. I mean, I've written neighboring here. They don't really have to be, just any pair of databases. This implication holds, okay? So a mechanism of sensitivity induced private for a pair of databases and a level of sensitivity, the sensitivity at those databases sort of instantaneously is bounded by this level, then we have this uniform over all measurable sets, sort of different pure differential privacy condition holding, but instantaneously on the pair of databases, okay? So you might have a mechanism that, you know, this doesn't hold for all pairs of neighboring databases, that's okay, just whenever sensitivity is good, running the mechanism with that sensitivity gives me a privacy condition, That's what I'm going to call sensitivity induced private. And then, not surprisingly, most generic mechanisms that are sensitivity based satisfy this definition. You could refactor the privacy guarantees for these things to kind of use this. And it's not saying anything. There's no insight into this. Okay. So Laplace and Gaussian, the target function is the thing you want to release. Okay, so Euclidean vectors, and that there are these norm spaces. For the Bernstein, which is what I'll hopefully get to, is a function release mechanism. So it's releasing a function from some set into R, real valued functions, and there's a norm on those. And for the exponential mechanism, it's a little bit different. It's not the thing you're trying to release per se. It's your score function. So indexed on a database, you release a function from responses to quality scores, right? And then the way you measure sensitivity is you take a max or a sup over absolute differences on all responses, okay? So this definition holds for lots of mechanisms. That's all I'm trying to point out. So if I have a distribution on data, I'm gonna talk about where this distribution comes from later. If we have a distribution, I can convert that implication for a sensitivity-induced private mechanism. I can convert it into this relation on these two probabilities, right? So if I draw databases according to p to the n plus one, so neighboring databases that are drawn ID according to this p, then this was the left-hand side of my implication. You know, the probability is upper bounded by this thing. That's nothing, okay? That's just the implication written in a different way. Now, the thing on the left is something that exists already. So this is yet another definition. It's not particularly new. It's called random differential privacy. I've not called it RDP because there's a more recent definition that's sometimes called RDP. So random differential privacy, it's due to a group at CMU, Hall, Ronaldo and Wasserman. And the idea is to say, we've got randomness in the data now, and it's a little bit like pufferfish in that sense, that the mechanism is likely to have pure DP randomness with randomness in the data, right? So there's certainly randomness in the mechanism in this, in saying epsilon DP, and then it's wrapped around with randomness in the data. And we've got some confidence. So there's confidence given by gamma, but also what affects our confidence in this is the choice of distribution. So in case I haven't said it already, I know I have to talk about that. I will. You should suspend disbelief for a little bit, but that's the intuition. So it's like pure DP holds except, you know, unlikely databases. Now you might not believe in that choice of databases, and that's fine. Okay. So the second thing, which is maybe another idea, is to start off by looking at what was on the right-hand side. Okay, so we had, this is RDP, this is interesting maybe, it's some kind of privacy guarantee on the mechanism, and then this is something. Okay, so let's imagine, okay, we've got our randomly drawn neighboring databases, and let's measure the sensitivity at those databases, okay, and that's another random variable. Like the sensitivity random variable. Okay, and so the thing that we had on the right-hand side is just the CDF of this thing. And so what the first idea is just saying is we get some confidence level that's given by the CDF of this random variable. Okay, and so if my goal is to not come up with delta myself, I could ask, okay, maybe what's the quantile? Right, what's the quantile of a confidence? So instead of choosing a sensitivity, maybe I'm happy to choose a confidence level. I choose that, and then I calculate an exact quantile. That's not easier than bounding sensitivity. Okay, so this doesn't help at all. We're just moving things around. We haven't actually solved anything. So this isn't really a good thing to do per se. If you look at the original paper on random differential privacy, they have some examples where they compute this kind of stuff. And it's not, you know, even for simple examples, it's not necessarily easy. You have to choose very nice and workable distributions in order to do this kind of thing. So that's not, we won't do that. What we'll instead do is we'll estimate quantiles instead of calculating them exactly. So here's the algorithm. So we want to sample IID from the sensitivity random variable. Some number of samples, lots and lots. Okay, thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, whatever. Is this an easy thing to do? Well, as long as it's easy to sample from your distribution, so you've got to keep that in mind when you're choosing a distribution, you've got to sample from it. And as long as you can evaluate your function, as long as you can calculate a norm, if you can do those three things, you can draw these samples, these observations from the sensitivity random variable. So we do this, we form the empirical CDF, and then we just invoke the DKW inequality. So it's a like a finite sample uniform convergence result. So it says that you basically have a uniform confidence band around an empirical CDF that includes the CDF with high probability. Okay, so I haven't written down what those expressions are, but they're rho prime and rho. You can sort of choose them, right? It depends on how many samples you have. And like this picture is supposed to show, what we'd really like to be able to do is invert this curve and get a sensitivity. But what we're instead going to do is be a little bit pessimistic. We're going to operate at a slightly higher sensitivity. We're going to maybe randomize a little bit more than we have to by sort of imagine there's a confidence band around the staircase. And so we're going to invert at slightly higher confidence, okay? And inverting the empirical CDF is really easy, right? You just sort your observations, you walk along, and that's it. So that's super easy to do. Yep.
So do you take the worst case over deep primes, the neighboring deep primes, or you sample G's and then like look for there are neighbors that ended up on the sample? So I'm just looking at the first line of the slide, and it defines G as the distance from between neighboring data sets, but you only sample D's or D's and D primes from the distribution.
Yeah, so they're both, which is obviously potentially problematic. Yeah. Yes, so there's no worst case. Yeah. So we're not going to get pure DP.
So what's the joint distribution on D and D prime? You sample D, then you sample a random index, and you replace the point with another random sample?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Or you assume that the function doesn't care about the order of data, and you just replace the last one. Okay, so what I've essentially proven is that you've got these things that we've talked about already. There's this sort of free parameter row. It depends how you write all of this down. It's either free or not. And you need to take a large number of samples of this sensitivity random variable. You need to figure out where you're going to go in the staircase. That's the order statistic. And you take that as your empirical sensitivity estimate. If you run your mechanism with this estimate, you get not pure DP or epsilon delta. You know, we could have done this for epsilon delta as well. There was nothing special about pure. But we don't have it holding on all pairs of databases. It's not worst case in the database. So we definitely pay something, right? But it's in somehow like random data. So this is random differential privacy. This is pufferfish kind of thing. So, okay, there's this, oh yeah.
So here we should think about gamma as being like cryptographically small, or like what's the typical?
I don't know, you decide. I think it needs to be small to believe in anything released. It needs to be very small in order to believe anything that's released from this thing. Are there cases where someone would be happy to run it with gamma as 0.01? Maybe. I think it depends if, are you doing this once? This also depends on compositions, which I'll talk about. So the answer is not necessarily simple. I think it's great. It would be great to hear from other people what they think. But yeah.
So presumably gamma is constrained by like the runtime for the sampling, right? Because you have to sample enough times to be able to estimate.
Yeah, for m to be big. Yes. So right. So you could choose your m, your budget. So this is the next slide. You might decide there's a gamma you like, or a 1 minus gamma in terms of confidence. You might instead decide that you have a certain amount of time, or you might sort of decide both and then use those things to set things, to set the other parameters. And we can solve for all of these things, and we've done that. This rho parameter, which comes from the sort of the confidence from DKW, uses this lambda w function. It's a standard special function, and I put special in quotes because I was worried the words would cancel out. It's implemented in most libraries of special functions. It's a multi-valued function, but we're always the second branch. It's always real valued. It's in the range we want. There's a recent bound on the second branch from Chatsugiorgio that you can use to sort of understand how the amount of effort grows with the confidence that you want, that you might want. So these kinds of questions could inform your choices about M, et cetera, et cetera. Now, depending on your distribution, if your distribution is data independent, which may not be good, you could do this sampling offline before data arrives. So, and it's also, the sampling is you can do in parallel. So for some analyses that might be complicated to analyze manually or analytically, you might be able to run them quickly and gather lots and lots and lots of samples. If you can't, obviously it's a problem because gamma won't be very small. This is, here I've plotted for not sufficiently larger range. I should have gone below, but I made this 2 years ago and I would have to open things up again, and I didn't, but I've got other plots later with smaller gammas. So you can see for 0.05, you need sort of a bit over 1,000. I vaguely remember 0.01, it's something like several thousand, maybe 10,000 or something like that. But it grows pretty quickly. And note the log scale, so don't be fooled. Okay, so one thing you can do is, just like with pure DP or all of your, whatever your favorite notion of differential privacy is, you can make trade-offs, right, between privacy and accuracy. So for this, you can change your gamma and essentially operate at a different quantile level. So you can have sort of better sensitivity if you're willing to have a different gamma, of course. Just like with random differential privacy before any sensitivity sampling, that's not new to this. But it depends on how many samples you want to do. So now let's talk about random differential privacy a little bit, because I think you can only suspend disbelief for so long. So this is my attempt to sort of think of pros and cons, and this is really like, if people don't like it, that's fine. I don't really have a horse in the game. Pure DP is my first true love. That's never going away. So the first thing to do is to talk about the distribution. Like, what could you use for the distribution? Do any of these make sense? Maybe for some cases. I think maybe for some cases, definitely not for others, or maybe not for many. So one is to sort of choose something non-informative, like uniform or Gaussian or something like that. Okay, you could do that. It might not be convincing. It really depends on the domain of your data. The advantage of that, though, is you can run things ahead of time and do lots and lots of samples. So that's happy. So you could analyze your function that you need sensitivity for a lot. Or you could use some prior knowledge from somewhere else, okay, but not data dependent. Or you could fit a density privately using some of your privacy budget. And then you could use the rest of your privacy budget to do sensitivity sampling from this private density. If you believe the private density is close to the real one, you have like a misspecified distribution that you're doing RDP on. Now, random differential privacy on one distribution does give you some kind of random differential privacy on a close distribution, but you want to be very close to sort of say it's the same thing. So those are some, you know, very, very preliminary thoughts. I mean, preliminary as of 2 years ago. I haven't thought, thought a lot about it since then, but, you know, definitely happy to discuss. In the derivation, I sort of imagined the databases were IID. Nothing really required that. What we required for DKW was that the observations of the sensitivity random variable were independent. That's we need that for DKW. So the within database could not be it doesn't have to be independent, but between they should be. Okay. We could also change the neighboring relation and sort of do something like, well, maybe not blowfish, but maybe pufferfish, to sort of recover something like that. So I've got this thing, and I don't know that I'm going to go through all of it now, but, you know, I think if you can do pure DP, of course you should, like no one should tell you otherwise. But there are situations where you might not be able to or might not want to. Approximate DP, you know, is pure DP except for unlikely responses. If you're willing to take that gamble, it depends on your delta, of course. Random DP, you know, you have pure DP holding except for unlikely databases. I can imagine in some cases, some people might be willing to do that. I don't know. It really depends on your distribution and your gamma.
So what examples do you think? What are the examples you can think that it's good? When do you think it's good?
I think if you're able to get gamma down very small, and you're using a distribution that you believe in, so you're doing something, you've got a data set that where we've had many other data sets before, they're very similar, we've got something slightly different, so I might believe in the distribution I'm using for random DP, gamma is small. If I don't need to use the data set a lot and I'm not worried about composition between different analyses, I might, so there's lots of ifs, right? But maybe in the, when all of those conditions are satisfied, I might be okay with it. I think it's also, I'd rather someone to use random DP than no DP at all. So that's another way to look at it from the other end, but I don't, that's a bit defeatist, maybe. But again, I think of Sisyphus and it's like, people don't use DP when they should. So on composition, so this is a good point that I do want to make. So approximate DP and sort of more recent notions like Renier DP compose well. So as far as I know, it's not known that random DP does. The in the original paper, they just use the union bound and it's terrible. It's like pure DP. Now you need, the way I think about composition, you need it for maybe two things. Maybe they're the same thing, I don't know. But you need it for certainly two things. You need it to develop our analyses on, you know, complicated algorithms that aren't just basic building blocks. And you also need it to track privacy budget over time, like when you run lots of analyses on the same data. So with the sensitivity sampler, you don't necessarily need composition to understand the privacy of one complicated analysis. You can just put it all in the black box and estimate its sensitivity. You do need composition though over time. So maybe in there's some use case. Yeah.
But the composition affects the distribution. That's the whole point. If I start with a belief that everything is gone from a particular distribution and I learn a few facts that contradictory to this distribution, then
I think maybe you mean like the non-adaptive case composition, the non-adaptive
yes.
case. Like
yes.
If you're asking queries based on the answers.
Oh, non-adaptive.
Yeah.
You cannot apply the new bound.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. So if I'm in the Australian Bureau of Statistics, say, and I'm doing some analysis and then in my department, and then I share it with someone else, and I should have been private, but it's like, it's okay. We're gonna make some decisions, we're gonna tune a bit, and then pull it back in. I would regard those as two separate things. It's really your threat model. So it really comes down to your threat model. Are you being adaptive? But that's a better way to say it, yeah. Okay, so I'll continue if okay.
How much time do I roughly have?
You still have about 10 minutes.
Okay. So very quickly, some toy empirical things. Yes?
Is there any privacy concern for the M samples that you use to estimate the sensitivity, or that's like...
Oh, would that leak privacy? It depends on your distribution that you chose. If it's data dependent and you didn't do anything to sanitize the distribution that you were drawing from, yes, there would be concerns. If it was differentially private or just not data dependent, then there wouldn't be any concerns. It depends on your function, but that's part of what is made public. So the short answer is no. Not in how I thought about it, but I'm sure you could do it wrong and yeah. So this is just some toy experiments with an SVM, a relatively small data set. We've been optimistic about the distribution generating the actual data and the one that we're using. On the left, it's just looking at sensitivity, sort of how bad our global analysis was. So I know that I'm competing with myself here, so it's not really fair, but it's pretty bad. Here's some sort of accuracy results. So this was like varying dimension. This is for dimension two, so very toy. And you can see, okay, this is epsilon budgets that are incredibly small, but like for sort of slightly bigger ones, you can see some difference, although gamma isn't that small here. So I think this gamma is probably too big for almost anything. I have other results in the slides with much smaller gammas, but I don't know if I'll get to show them, but I can show you afterwards. So that's a sensitivity sampler. For a few minutes, I'll quickly talk about a way to do private function release. Matthew on Monday talked about a more recent way, and he did cite this. So his way is probably better. My way is just another way. I'm giving excuses for not comparing. My other excuse is that ours was 2017, and so somehow that gets me off the hook for comparing things, but I don't know. So what we're trying to do in this work, which in a sense complements because it's another sensitivity-based mechanism, is we want to release functions, okay? And so we want to release functions with bounded data in some dimension. This could be like a learning algorithm. And we want to do something fairly simple that doesn't require a lot of information. We don't want to have many restrictions on the functions that we can privatize. So it's a similar kind of thinking as a sensitivity sampler. So we don't assume these functions are separable or anything in the data. They can really be anything. To get utility bounds, we need to assume some smoothness though. But for privacy, we don't need to assume anything. So we have some parameters, and this is the algorithm. We get our non-private function, okay? So we run learning. So G is the thing we want to release. We have a grid. It doesn't necessarily have to be a sort of even grid. You could somehow be clever and adapt, and we haven't been clever so far. We just have a regular grid on the domain. And so you can imagine already as the domain grows, as the dimension grows, you're in trouble. So actually the thing we do assume is the dimension isn't too big. We essentially evaluate this and get coefficients in a basis, which actually just involves evaluating the function. So when I say approximate, I actually just mean evaluate. Then we perturb these coefficients by Laplace, but you could use something else, doesn't have to be Laplace. Then you just release them, and then that's it for the privatization bit. And then to actually use this approximate function to make predictions, if it's a classifier or to evaluate it, you need the basis functions that these coefficients are relative to. The basis functions aren't data dependent, and so you just take a linear combination of the perturbed coefficients with the basis functions. What I haven't said is what are the basis functions. That's the next slide. But this is the algorithm. The basis functions, they're Bernstein polynomials. They come about in the Weierstrass theorem for uniformly approximating continuous functions. They're very neat. They're basically like they're essentially the binomial PMF. So that's what they are. So they have some degree that you can choose. There are k plus one of them. The coefficients in this basis are just the evaluations, which is really nice. It's really easy to do. And the Bernstein operator, which is how to reconstruct the function in this basis, is just this linear combination of these basis functions. So this is like an expectation. So taking a binomial random variable and then taking the expectation essentially with respect to that random variable of G evaluated with that thing. But where the distribution of the binomial variable does depend on the test point, essentially. So this is a picture of a blue Bernstein approximation to some function that I made up. Okay. So you get privacy. You get pure DP if you know sensitivity. You get utility too. You get it by a concentration result by Prochan. So the thing to sort of notice is that we've got a convex combination. So the convex combination is because we have a distribution. And so we're using that. And we're also just using the Weierstrass theorem because the approximation within the basis is close to the original thing. So it's just that. And depending on what you assume about smoothness of your original function that isn't private, you get some kind of utility. And it doesn't scale that nicely in dimension. So that's the short, quick summary of the Bernstein mechanism. So let me show you putting the Bernstein mechanism and the sensitivity sampler together. I was happy when I heard John Ducci yesterday mention doing things in R, because, okay, here is in R. It's like as if I prepared it overnight. Like, what a good idea. I wonder if you could do that. No, it was prepared before. So what I'm going to do is show an example of using these things together for the Priestley-Chow kernel regression. Why did we choose that? Because when we were doing Bernstein, we wanted some algorithm where the function you want to release isn't separable in the data. It's not like a sum. So this isn't so easy. And at the time, other function release mechanisms couldn't do this kind of thing. So Bernstein can. So what I'll show you is some synthetic data, the non-private kernel regression, and then you'll see sensitivity sampling happening for just 500 samples, so it's not going to be very confident, and you'll see the approximation. Hopefully it'll work. No, it doesn't want to. Yes. Okay, there's the synthetic data. There's the non-private kernel regression. And now it's doing sensitivity sampling now, or sometime then. It's kind of not so fun watching it, but it's just it doesn't take long. And there's a private one, but if you look at the parameters there, gamma is 0.2, so don't do this at home. Do not do this. Like, you need gamma much smaller, you need to wait longer, you need larger M, okay? So it's just for a talk. So very quickly, we have implemented all of the ideas mentioned in an R package. Because it's on CRAN, this is all, if you have an internet connection in R, this is all you need to do to use it, and then you can write things. Now, it's missing lots of things. It's not, you know, quite there yet. You know, it'd be great to improve it. If anyone wants to work on it together, that would be awesome. So that's sort of the talk. Just to summarize what I talked about, while differential privacy is fantastic and it's had sort of incredible successes, we still are seeing kind of these crazy things happen in privacy, right? And it's not just breaches, it's also crazy solutions. Like, people still don't know differential privacy, and it's just crazy. And I don't think that it's necessarily something deficient in privacy, but it's something to think about anyway. It's something to kind of look at every now and then. I talked about the sensitivity sampler, which is maybe has some use cases sometimes. And it lets you avoid bounding global sensitivity when it's hard to do, or where you don't trust your implementation. Okay. I talked extremely quickly about the Bernstein mechanism for private function release as well. Thanks.
Time for a couple questions until the next speaker is set up. Yeah.
Isn't, in a way, bounding the type of functions you're trying to estimate also, in a way, bounding the sensitivity of the data? Because you started by mentioning the fact that we sometimes don't know what is the original sensitivity of the data, so we don't know how to calibrate the noise, etc. But like, you have an estimation here about the data because you have an assumption about the data because you have an assumption about what type of functions you need. It can be a crazy data. It can be a function going crazy. So isn't it possible to just hit the bound and the sensitivity somewhere in the function? But it's going back to the issue of how much can we bound the sensitivity of the data?
I missed the beginning of the question, but I think I got the gist of it. But apologies if I'm not answering directly. I think that pure DP does involve data, right? I mean, the sensitivity involves data, but in a sense, you avoid using it. You avoid being data dependent because you bound sensitivity worst case over all databases, and so that's why pure DP is such a strong privacy guarantee. Because it doesn't matter what your data set is. It doesn't matter what auxiliary information you have. You know, it's great. That's why it's so powerful. But of course, the data set that you really have might not be worst case. And in a sense, maybe you could say ideas of like smooth sensitivity and local sensitivity and things like that is a way of exploiting this idea. Things like random differential privacy and pufferfish, etc., you're definitely relaxing your privacy guarantee, and you're making an assumption that you know something about where the data is coming from. And so you could be misspecified and you might not have a good privacy guarantee if you use this. And it is about the sensitivity because we're bounding sensitivity using some assumption. So you're right. But it's not leaking. I mean, the sensitivity itself isn't what's leaking things, it's running the mechanism with insufficient sensitivity. So that's kind of where you get into trouble if you're very misspecified.
Let's thank our speaker again.